not conceive of any Swaraj in which the workers and the peasants had no hand in the administration of the state. Despite Gandhi's desperate pleading, Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev were executed on the eve of the Karachi Congress. The Karachi Congress, convened under the shadow of Bhagat Singh's execution, truly represented the temper of the country at the moment. As Gandhi arrived, the demonstrators greeted him with black flags and shouts of "Down with Gandhiism" and "Long live Bhagat Singh." Gandhi received them sweetly and smilingly accepted the black flowers, and their indignation completely subsided. The Congress had a strong contingent of Khudai Khidmatgars, servants of God. They had played a conspicuous part in the civil disobedience movement in the frontier province under the leadership of Abdul Ghaffar Khan, called Frontier Gandhi. At the Congress, the awakened spirit of the people was very much in evidence. It adopted a charter of fundamental rights embodying Gandhi's 11 points and a few more introduced by Jawaharlal Nehru, enumerating civic liberties, universal adult suffrage, free and compulsory education, and nationalization of key industries, and stress the secular character of the state. Thus, the Congress took a step in the socialist direction to lessen the burden of the poor. The Congress session marked the pinnacle of Gandhi's popularity and prestige with the people. The Congress ratified the Gandhi-Irwin Agreement and appointed Gandhi as the sole Congress representative at the Round Table Conference. The colors of the national flag were changed at Gandhi's instance. White, green, and red were replaced by saffron, standing for courage and sacrifice, white for truth and peace, green for faith and strength. The spinning wheel represented the hope of the masses. Gandhi reached Bombay on August 29th to catch the boat in time. A special passport was issued to enable him to make a dash for London. The Indian plenipotentiary arrived not for waging a battle of diplomacy, but for embarking on his mission of asserting the right of the Indian people to be masters of their destiny and cultivating friendship with the world. Accompanying Gandhi were two fellow delegates, Sarojini Naidu and Madan Mohan Malaviya. At noon on August 29th, the Rajputana steamed out. Jawaharlal Nehru watched the ship that carried the sole representative of one-fifth of the human race to the Arabian Sea and the Far West. Gandhi was in the best of spirits during the voyage. Riding the pitching seas like a veteran mariner, he selected for himself a corner on the second-class deck where he spent most of the day and the whole of the night under the canopy of the starlit sky. The quaint traveler carried the scantiest of luggage and scrupulously observed his daily routine on board the ship. After a weary voyage of 1,660 miles, daylight broke over the rock-crested shores of Aden. Gandhi steered the Rajputana into the first port of call. "I hope I do not capsize the boat," he remarked as he turned the wheel. A big welcome awaited Gandhi at Aden. He arrived at the citizens' meeting to receive an address of welcome and a purse. In his first public speech outside the Indian subcontinent since 1914, he declared that India did not stand for isolated independence. One-fifth of the human race becoming free through non-violence and truth can be a great force of service to the whole of mankind. He extolled the simple way of life associated with the Khalifs and told the Arabs to help solve the Hindu-Muslim problem. As the ship was gliding through the Suez, messages of welcome from the Egyptians poured in. On crossing the Egyptian waters, Madame Zaghloul Pasha sent the great leader of Great India her best wishes for the success of the Indian cause. Gandhi had in his loyal secretary Mahadev Desai an assistant who not merely relieved him of much of his routine work, but put his keen intellect and tireless capacity for work at his disposal. Mahadev's devotion to Gandhi was complete, and Gandhi's affection for him deep and unbounded. On the misty, cold morning of September 11th, SS Rajputana anchored at Marseille. When the spiritual ambassador of India alighted on the soil of war-weary Europe, he was hailed with shouts of Vive la Gandhi. At Folkestone on September 12th, Britons gathered to greet the guest of the nation. Gandhi landed on British soil with thoughts of the hard task ahead. I am here to vindicate the honor of India and to uphold truth as I see it, for I believe it is the keystone of life. Gandhi had accepted Muriel Lester's invitation to stay at Kingsley Hall, a center dedicated to the slums of London. The members of every section of Bow assembled outside Kingsley Hall to welcome Gandhi. The pearly king, accompanied by his son and daughter, came to pay respects to the distinguished visitor in his domain. Gandhi greeted the costermonger royalties who offered him their best oranges.
Take the orange, yeah. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. Why take only one? I take two. Kill.
At the Federal Structure Committee of the Round Table Conference held at St. James's Palace, the voice of resurgent India spoke through Gandhi. The goal of absolute independence remains intact. Gandhi stressed the need of adult suffrage and racial equality and advocated an honorable partnership between India and Britain. The nation that does not control its defense forces and external policy, asserted Gandhi, is hardly a responsible nation. He struck a note of warning. A nation of 350 million people needs simply a will of its own to say no, and that nation is today learning to say no.